Hi, I'm Dr. Jack West, medical oncologist at City of Hope Comprehensive Cancer Center in Los Angeles. This is Westwind, a podcast focusing on the intersection of cancer care, emerging technology issues in medicine, and healthcare policy. You can find information about subscribing at beaconmedic.com or wherever you find your podcast content. Please leave a review, especially if you like this, and we'd also love to get your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Continuing our discussion with Dr. Esther Choo in this episode now. So let's talk about that creep of the academic life, because you've had and continue to have your academic appointment. You write extensively, you speak in all sorts of settings, but among those are very high-powered conventional academic settings. Can you talk about what you've alluded to in the past in other settings about the kind of opportunities that women versus men are often getting in the academic setting and the different paths that leads to in terms of career ascension?
Yeah, I'm right in the thick of it. It's very obvious to me that when you start out and there's less at stake, the opportunities are similar. And so I think for that reason, when you're going through medical school and residency, it is possible to ignore the impact of gender and other factors, but particularly gender, because I think there are ways in which race and other, you know, identities affect you earlier. You know, I think for gender, there are many times in which people really feel like it's not an issue. It's simply not an issue. I mean, I didn't think of it at all until I was well into my early career. I was in a residency class that was majority female. I was one of three chiefs. Two of us were women and one was male. We had this kind of joke that we couldn't remember whether or not there were any men in our class. I mean, the women were so strong and vocal in my training program that we just kind of dominated. And so I was in this rarefied setting to really be blind to the way that gender profoundly affected women's careers. I mean, it was happening in my group to my attendings. There were gender-based things, but I just wasn't in a mental place to see it at all. And then as I went through my career and shared stories with my increasingly large network of women, we all kind of had similar experiences where we went in full of promise and energy and optimism and initially didn't feel that our experiences were different, and then started to see these little markers of different progress and opportunity, you know, like sort of our people we considered to be our exact peers getting slightly more money for the same job or getting boosted into these leadership roles really quickly, you know, just kind of accelerating past us, and we couldn't figure out what it was. And, you know, your tendency is to attribute it to having kids, but not all of us were having kids at that point. You know, I think there were enough of us kind of with delayed timelines and starting families, or just, you know, didn't go that route to have kids, that we were kind of like, I'm here not having kids and I'm still not getting accelerated like this guy right next to me. And what is going on? Is it me? You know, so then you go through a whole cycle of, is it me? And then you get to mid-career and you kind of look around and you realize every woman you know, almost every woman, is in a very similar boat where we really have to create our own opportunity. It is not handed to us, whereas we see it being readily handed off to men who are kind of comparable or not even as accomplished as you are. And, you know, my husband and I had a round of conversation that kind of poked its head on social media because he wanted to openly acknowledge it. But my husband is in a position where as a smart white guy, he has to hide from opportunity. Like, leadership positions come hunting for him so aggressively that he feels like he has to hide from it. He sort of has different priorities in his career, and his CV is nothing like mine, but he's like, it's just ridiculous because there's very little that I can do to get to a traditional leadership position, and there's little that he can do to avoid getting suggested for them. And we kind of consider our experience so typical for what happens with men and women, and that becomes particularly obvious in this mid part of our careers.
Can you talk about the Time's Up Healthcare Initiative, what that is, and where that's going?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's been an exciting opportunity for me. And actually, just like riffing off the last point, I think the way that women continue to challenge themselves and actually develop leadership experience is often by stepping out of traditional, you know, structures and organizations, and also by entering this space of work in gender and other types of inequities. So I had sort of for a number of years had been really interested in the careers of women. And so I did a little bit of women's development work through my specialty society, through the Society of Academic Emergency Medicine. And then just as a researcher, really got into the data. And there's been just this really fascinated body of research that's coming out about the way that women and men's careers in healthcare play out and all the different forces that are influencing that. And so a friend and I met on a women's physician Facebook group, and we both had the same pet peeve, which is that we never really measure meaningful metrics when it comes to culture for women in healthcare settings. And, you know, so we do all these things to try to improve culture, like we do, you'll do campus-wide implicit bias training, and you'll create a wonderful faculty development program, and you'll do women's networking or send them on retreats or have better sexual harassment training, and then nobody can ever tell you if it's working, you know, or what the impact of that all-day training was. And so we're like, why don't we have better metrics for sort of intermediate outcomes, not just how many women quit or how many sexual harassment complaints go to lawsuits? Why don't we have better metrics that are more upstream? And so we created this company called Equity Quotient that develops these metrics and deploys them in healthcare settings. So I was working on that, and also my social media account was taken off in a good way. And a mutual friend on social media tagged us along with some of the Time's Up healthcare leaders. And that led to a phone conversation and then an in-person meeting. And then pretty soon we kind of were confronted with the fact that what's happening in healthcare is happening across industries, that this was a wonderful opportunity to partner with a national organization. And the way we ended up setting it up was that we became one of Time's Up's initiatives under their nonprofit arm and called ourselves Time's Up Healthcare. And so as somebody who was in on the early conversations and also finally came to the conclusion that we needed to go for it, I became one of the steering committee members and doing a lot of organizational work for this effort.
Great. So let's talk about your social media presence, which is phenomenal. I mean, you're a monster and you're fearless. I mean, I give you a lot of props for just confronting so many potentially challenging issues that I think a lot of us in medicine may see and think about, but may not confront as directly as you do. And I think that may potentially make you somewhat of a lightning rod. Can you talk about, have you been trolled much? Is that a big issue for you? Or is it so overwhelmingly positive that any criticism you get just rolls off your back?
Yeah, there was a period in which I needed to just shut off notifications and inbox messages. So you can only message me if I follow you. And I simply don't see the trolls for the most part, unless somebody tags me and is like, did you see what horrible thing this person wrote? And I do a lot of blocking and muting of people who are clearly trolls. And, you know, to be clear, I don't block or mute because somebody disagrees with me. I think that is what makes you grow as a person and as an advocate. But if there's a clear troll, I block that quickly. It is just not worth anybody's emotional energy to engage with trolls. So my filter is pretty strong, which is why I don't spend a lot of time wallowing in the criticism, but it finds its way to me for sure. I mean, people will call my place of employment, will complain to people who work with me. I'll get letters in the mail that are pretty hurtful. And that is just part of the whole package. I mean, if you're visible and you have clear opinions, then, you know, it attracts negative as well as positive energy. So I think I'm trying to be pretty reasonable about it. I mean, I think all of us tend to be more attuned to negative comments than to positive ones. And I just have to objectively admit that there is a lot of positive support. And that is what enables me to continue to be as honest as I am about my viewpoints.
Did you worry at all as you started to speak out more clearly and certainly have a broader audience that you would be compromising the momentum that you've built up in your more conventional academic trajectory? I mean, is that something were you worried about poisoning the well or the good feeling? Is that something that you thought of and said, I understand, but I have to do this? And What are you thinking now about how it has affected the range of opportunities you've had both in and outside of academia?
Yeah, I had a pause, maybe the briefest of pauses, when I thought about, could this hurt my academic progress? I mean, you know as well, when you get to a certain point in academia, you've worked so hard for so long for where you are. The idea of risking that is just, you don't go into medicine because you're a huge risk taker, right? I mean, all mm-hmm. of us follow a pretty traditional path and there aren't a lot of surprises. But it was really just the briefest of pauses because I mean, ultimately we all have to live with our own conscience. And I got to a point where I felt like I could not be myself and be honest without speaking out on this platform that I had access to, and that it was a disservice to people who didn't have the platform. And I just kind of felt like I couldn't hold it in. You know, it was just stuff that needed to get out there. And if I could, you know, often it's not even my own message. It's amplifying other people's whose messages are very well developed and articulated, and just knowing that I could amplify what they had to say. So it was a thought, you know, I think I held back for a long time. And if anything, I look back and regret that I wasn't more outspoken earlier on about things that I was observing. So once I started, just the floodgates opened and I haven't really looked back. And you're totally right. I mean, now that I'm a couple years into being very active on social media, it's funny looking back because so clearly it's actually given me so much opportunity in traditional medicine because, I mean, who knew? These topics just are coming to the forefront. People really want to hear about them. I mean, I thought that I would be kind of writing on the side and getting my friends to put my pieces on their websites. But instead, it's my nature of activism has found out in places like New England Journal and The Lancet and the BMJ. I mean, I couldn't have dreamt that that would happen. But I think there's just something about the timing of these topics.
How do those compare to your increasing presence on more mass media channels? I mean, you do appearances on, you know, NBC and various other things. That can you get there by academic publications alone, or do you feel like your academic focus in some way competes with the opportunity to reach a broader audience?
I don't really know the answer. I mean, I think having some academic presence gives you the legitimacy to go in front of a larger audience. And I also think for me, my advocacy is not separable from my identity and background as a researcher. You know, I mean, the reason that I feel confident going up there is not because I'm like so natural in front of people. In fact, I'm pretty terrified of most public appearances, but I have a foundation of understanding the data, and that gives me a lot more confidence and authority when I do speak. It's not just kind of like I've got these feelings and I'm going to talk about it. I almost always speak from the data. So I think the academic part of me is why I have the courage to go out there. I don't think that's the route for everybody, but that's what it was for me.
Can you talk about the points you've made about the oil paintings on the walls in the auditoriums of renowned institutions being so predominantly older white men? Can you just elaborate on that thought process and the feedback that you've gotten, as well as how you've heard that things are or are not changing in the hallowed halls of our most known institutions?
Yeah, I think it comes down to the fact that we can have all the sophisticated conversations that we want, but simple things like optics and representation matter, you know? And so I was at a hospital one year and we had just come out of this really wonderful training about gender bias and other types of implicit bias. And we were walking out, we walked down this long hallway of all male portraiture. And another participant of the workshop was walking with me and she said, "It's just hard for me on a gut level to feel like anything happened when look at the structure of the building that we're in, look at these portraits. It's like nothing really has changed just because we had a one-day workshop." And I just think we cannot recruit the kind of workforce we want when every time you look at a wall, at a building, at people on a panel, you know, at who is represented on stage and honored with awards and quoted in the media and represented on TV. If those faces are all homogeneous, how are we supposed to attract
this diverse workforce? You know, how are we supposed to sustain them, yet never honor them or quote them or validate their opinions? And so all of this has to go together. You know, we can't just have this big picture intellectual conversation and yet not address these very obvious things that are kind of hitting you in the face. So to me, those seemingly superficial things really matter deeply. And so I think it all needs to come together.
But there have been some changes executed on the basis of these articulated concerns. Is that not right?
Yeah, I mean, there are some really momentous occasions. I mean, the portraiture issue came up most recently because Harvard Medical School decided to take down some of its traditional portraiture from its main medical school auditorium, which I think was painful at an institution where they really honor tradition and history. So you do see these moments. And then there's also been this wonderful movement among prominent men in science and medicine where they will, for example, refuse to participate in a panel where there are no women or where there is a token woman. Or there's a prominent science writer named Ed Yong who made a commitment to increase the gender diversity of those he quoted, realizing that most science articles quote men and only men, which gives the impression that, you know, that there's no one of expertise or authority who is a woman who can speak to those issues, and also doesn't provide diversity of thought and of input. So I think these kind of things are becoming more and more common. And I feel like there's kind of we're approaching a tipping point where it doesn't have to be just that one or two prominent men doing that, but it's just the norm that you wouldn't want to be up there on a mantle because that would be terribly embarrassing for everybody.
You articulated that you feel that your work in the ER, your academic pursuits, and your social commentary, both online and from a podium, all dovetail together. Do you have concern that you just have so many potentially competing issues with your time? I mean, there's only 24 hours in a day, and you have a family, and I'm sure other personal interests. Do you have any concern that something's got to give and you may need to direct more of your efforts to just focusing on the policy and education, or potentially backing off of that to focus more on medicine? Or do you just think that they are a kind of virtuous circle that are so intertwined that there is no dichotomy there?
This is really the issue of my life right now. And I think the problem is,
I would imagine so.
The problem is when you're so busy that you can't take a break to sort of look at 30,000 foot view, it's very hard to make these decisions. So far it's been willful ignorance of the fact that at some point I have to stop and probably make a decision. But I think there are efficiencies, you know? I mean, a lot of my academic interests are really turning towards gender and racial disparities, whether that's in clinical care or policy work or the workforce. So that kind of converges nicely with advocacy and with the popular writing that I do and with the lecturing that I do. And so, you know, and I'm a big believer in kind of turning everything into a triple product, you know? And so if I'm going to speak, then I want to use that time to also reflect and write on that same topic. And then, you know, if there's something else in terms of mentoring or making connections for Times Up Healthcare or something like that, you know, I try to milk every single opportunity and milk as much productivity across domains as I can. So there are certainly efficiencies. And then a lot of this gets easier. You know, the first time that I did a gender bias talk or a sexual harassment talk, I mean, the hours that go into it are countless. Every single time I give it, it takes a little bit less time to prepare for that. And so I do think that there's some things that are just easy and easier as I go, although none of this kind of work is ever truly easy. But there are certainly moments where I feel like I would love to just do fewer things and do them well. You know, I mean, I got advice from a friend that kind of perfect is the enemy of the good sort of thing when I really felt like my life was mm-hmm. overwhelming, like maybe not be so anal about every single piece or try to delegate work. And those are things that I just don't come to me very naturally. So I'm trying to build some skills in that sense. But I do think the truth is, knowing my own capability, am I someone who gets to be the most amazing physician also teach residents well at the bedside and do research mentorship, which I love to do, and also do good science, get massive funding, be an advocate, a presence on social media, write for the popular press, appear on TV, build a nonprofit. Like, can I, and also run every day? I mean, can I do all those things in a sustained and high quality fashion and still be a great mom? Probably not. I mean, it doesn't, sounds kind of crazy as I listen to myself talk about it. And so there have to be choices. And my great fortune in life is you could randomly pick any two or three of these activities out of a hat and tell me that's all I get to do. And I would be really happy for the rest of my life. And so, I mean, that is not something that I can complain about. And so I'm super lucky. And when I peel off from one thing or the other, it'll be just knowing that I am blessed to just turn my attention to something else that I just love and feel so lucky to do. So I just, you know, I appreciate this dilemma. I'm tremendously lucky to have it.
Well, it seems like people have said to me, how do you get the things done and still sleep, et cetera. But I look at your life and think, I don't know how you manage. I mean, it's like, it is the enviable champagne problem, like a found money dream of, right. You know, you have endless opportunities for fascinating, amazing things to do, but we're all operating with the same, you know, you haven't broken the time-space continuum. And so I think that's going to be, it's just at some point, it's just hard to make choices, but at least you have choices of many great things to do. It's just exciting to think of what you might do with the time you have. I know you'll be very productive with it. I just think also about, you know, Anne-Marie Slaughter years ago wrote about you can't have it all.
Right.
And I think that's true for men and women, that with all of the career opportunities, our personal, not just obligations, but our commitments and our desires to be present for our families. It's tough, but you make it look easy. I'll say that. And I really appreciate your taking the time. I know our listeners will as well. And I would strongly encourage people to follow Esther on social media because she's a fascinating, thought-provoking person, and as I said, seemingly fearless. So it's been a privilege to talk to you, and I've really enjoyed everything that you bring to the public discussion. And thanks so much. Take care.
Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thanks so much for joining me today for this West Wind podcast. We hope you'll be interested enough to subscribe either by checking out the options at beaconmedic.com. Or looking for West Wind Podcast on iTunes or wherever you find your audio content. Please take the time to submit a review, and we'd also welcome your feedback at westwindpodcast@gmail.com. Until next time, this is Dr. Jack West. Thanks for listening.